Hi, I am Pastor Patricia Hamer. Welcome to Abiding Faith Christian Center's Thursday night Bible study. My husband, Pastor Rodney, and I are excited about you joining us on tonight and about bringing you the Word of God on today. Our mission is establishing, empowering, and maturing lives to fulfill God's divine destiny and His purpose. On tonight, you will be renewed in your mind and built up in your spirit. So get ready, grab your Bible, your iPhone, your iPad, or however you access the Word of God. And also, you may want to get pencil and paper so that you can take good notes. Pastor Rodney has a good word for us, and we don't want you to forget the word on tonight. And while you're getting ready, I would like to inform you that Abiding Faith Christian Center Thursday Night Bible Study is located at Eagle Ridge Community Square. And that's the Eagle Ridge Square Community Center, located at Eagle Ridge Square. And it's at 6101 Eagle Ridge Lane, Flint, Michigan, 48505. That's off Selby between Pearson and Carpenter Road. We invite you to come out on Thursday night and visit with us for just 1 hour, 6 to 7 p.m. in the Word of God. It will not be an hour wasted. So if you're close by, you still have time to get here to get in on the Word of God. So are you ready to hear the Word? Well, here's Pastor Rodney.
All right. Well, praise the Lord. Let's get into this Word. Amen. Again, as I said before, we started a message called Getting Understanding, Understanding the Basics of Operating in Faith. And we said that the word basics, because understanding the basics, the word basics means the central and most important principles of something. That's what basic means. Our foundational scripture for this message, how it came together by the Holy Spirit when He gave this to me, was out of the book of Hebrews, the 6th chapter, verse number 1. You can turn there in your Bibles if you want to. I'm going to turn there myself, praise God. So bear with me as I bring my Bible up here on my tablet. I like these modern tablets, but I do like my page Bible. I do the study at home, my page Bible. But when I'm ministering, I like to use this because it can get me to the scriptures a lot faster than turning the pages and without tearing my pages. Got some tears in my pages because when I'm turning my pages, sometimes I get a little bit heavy-handed. Here in Hebrews, the 6th chapter, verse number 1, listen what the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul writes to us, the believer, the church today. He says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, the word doctrine means the established order of God, or the teachings of Christ. He said, let us go on unto perfection. So that implies that God wants us to go on to perfection. Is that true? God wants us to grow, praise God. That's why it says, go, let us. And He says us, that means you and me, let us go on unto perfection. And then He says, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. Now I'm going to stop right there because we've been teaching about understanding the basics of the operations of faith. Basics, which means the fundamental principles of something. And here we're talking about the Word of God. So God wants us to go on unto perfection of faith towards God. We want to now move on because we want to find out how you can know that you have faith. Knowing if you have faith. Knowing if you have faith. Have you ever heard someone says, well, Pastor, I don't have any faith. If I only had some faith. You ever heard someone say that? I know you haven't said it yourself, but there are people that do say, I don't have any faith. If I only have some faith. Well, you heard the disciples one time, they said, Lord, increase our faith. Well, faith can be increasing. We're going to talk about that some other time. But right now we want to teach you so that you can know for at any given time that you have faith. Every believer has faith, in case you didn't know it. But I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, to the 11th chapter. And we want to look at verse number 1, Hebrews chapter 11. Probably very familiar with you, Hebrews chapter, the 11th chapter. Familiar with many of you. Many of you in the body of Christ, Hebrews 11 chapter. How you can know that you have faith, praise God. Knowing if you have faith. That's what the title is. Knowing if you have faith. Here in Hebrews 11 chapter, many scholars believe that the Apostle Paul was the writer of the book of Hebrews. So we could say that the Holy Spirit is speaking through the Apostle Paul here in Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 1. And notice what the Spirit of God inspires him to write. So it's God speaking to us. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I want you to notice what it says. It says, now faith is. Now, we know that the word noun is not a word that you can use it as a time frame, amen. Etymologically, it doesn't mean a time frame, but we can use it as saying a time frame. When it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, and then it says, the evidence of things not seen. The evidence of things not seen. Now, let's break this down here. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Now, the word hope right here, we can change the word hope and we can say it like this. Now faith is the substance of things desired, wished, or dreamed for. Did you get that? The word hope, we can substitute the words. Now the faith is the substance of things wished for, dreamed for. Amen? The word hope can be used, substitute with the word wish or dream. You ever wish for something? You ever wish for whatever? Yes, I wish I had this, and I wish I was this, and I wish this. Or you may dream. You know, some people daydream, some people dream at night. Amen? And you're dreaming about something, and that's something that you dream about. Maybe a desire, a strong desire in your heart. I don't know, but you're just dreaming. But did you notice? It says that faith is the substance of things dreamed for. Faith is the substance of things hoped for or wished for. Faith is the substance. Now, the word substance can also be defined, well, actually, verse substance means that which has a tangibility. That which is tangible. I guess the best way I can put tangible, amen? That's what substance means. It has a tangibility to it, amen? So we say now faith is the substance or the tangibility of things hoped for. And then it goes and says the evidence. What about the word evidence? Well, the word evidence can be the proof of, the substantiating proof of. That's what evidence means. It means the proof of. When you go to court and then you trying to argue your case before a judge and stuff and the jury and stuff, and you saying, well, such and such a thing happened at such and such a time, and they say, well, do you have any evidence? And so, yes, Your Honor, I do have some evidence. I'd like to present to you Exhibit A, which is evidence of such and such a thing, whatever you plead in your case for in court. So it says here, faith is the evidence, the proof. And then it says of things not seen, the things not seen. Well, many of you know that there's some things that you can see that you can't hear, or there's some things that you can see that you can't smell. Are there some things that you can see that you can't taste and what have you, or vice versa? There's some things that you can hear that you cannot smell, right? There's some things that you can hear that you can't see. Am I right? I mean, you can hear music coming over a loudspeaker, but you can't see the music, amen? You can't see the notes, praise God, that's coming over the loudspeaker or through earphones you may have or coming through the television, praise God. So when it says here that faith is the evidence of things not seen, we can say faith is not the evidence of things not perceived by the senses, because we don't want to just limit the word seen here in verse number 11 just to visual perception. Because when you read the word seen, that's what you think about. You think about visual perception. So we don't want to just limit it to visual perception. So that's why I said the word seen can also be defined as to be heard, smelled, tasted, or touched. Amen? Now, so this faith stuff that we're teaching about must be very important. Now, remember, we found out where faith comes from, right? Because this faith, which is the substance of things hoped for, this faith, which is the evidence of things not perceived by the physical senses, has to come from somewhere. Amen? Amen. It has to come from somewhere. Well, where does it come from? Well, remember Romans the 10th chapter, the 17th verse. Turn to Romans the 10th chapter, the 17th verse, and we're going to find out where this faith comes from. I know you're familiar with it last week. If you were here or you were listening on the Periscope or you looked at it on Facebook or whatever. But we just want to go there. Humor me just to go back it again, because we said before, faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing by the word of God. Amen. Hearing on a continuous sense. Romans the 10th chapter. We want to look at verse number 17, because we want to find out about this faith, which is the substance of things hoped for, and this faith, which is the evidence or the proof of things not perceived by the senses. Amen. This faith is the substance, the tangibility of the things that you wish and hope for. Wishing, hoping, it has no tangibility to it. Dreams have no tangibility to it. But faith will give tangibility to your dreams. Faith will give tangibility to your wishes and your hopes. Faith will become the evidence of the thing that you are believing God for until it comes on the scene in the natural. Amen? Now look what it says here in Romans the 10th chapter, verse number 17. It says, so then faith cometh by what? Cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So then faith comes by what? It comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. So we see that faith comes from somewhere. As we said earlier, it comes from the hearing of the word. So this faith, which is the substance of things hoped for, this faith, which is the evidence of things not perceived by the senses, this faith, which has a tangibility to it, and which is also can be used as an evidence of that which cannot be perceived by the senses, comes from the word of God, my brother and sister. Amen. Now listen, look at Romans the 12th chapter and the 3rd verse. We want to find out if you have faith. How you can know if you have faith. How do I know I have faith, Pastor? Well, I'm going to show you right here in Romans the 12th chapter. I'm going to show you Romans 12th chapter in verse number 3, and I'm going to show you some other things in a minute too. Hallelujah. I'm getting excited about this. I need to slow down. Oh, glory to God. Romans 12:3. Ooh, we're already in Romans now. I'm just going to go to the 12th chapter, and we want to look at verse number 3. How can you know that you have faith? Because you need to know that you have faith. Many believers don't believe they have faith. They say, if I only had some faith, can you pray for me that I can get some faith? I don't have any faith, Pastor. Yes, you do. You have faith. You just don't know that you have faith. And the reason why you don't know it, because you've never been taught. You've never been taught it from the Word of God. Some of you have been taught a lot of other things, but you've not been taught the Word of God. You've heard a lot of wisdom of words, but you haven't been taught the word of faith. And that's important for you, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Here in Romans, the 12th chapter, I believe everybody's there by now. Look what it says in verse number 3. For I say, through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than you ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God, listen, has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, what is a measure? Well, if we had a measuring cup, where it was one fourth, or one third, or one half, or one cup, or what have you, amen? Well, those one half is a measure, one fourth is a measure, one third is a measure, amen? The Bible says God has dealt unto every man, listen, the measure of faith. And according as God, he said, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than you ought to think. Don't think that you all that in the bag of chips. Are you better than somebody else? Because since you came to Christ, you came and you got the same things everybody else got. Amen. Why? Because God is no respecter of person. Now you see different people operating in great faith. People doing a lot of great works for God. Preachers, ministries. You see them doing a lot of things for God. People operating in great faith. But that's not because God gave them great faith and didn't give you great faith. It's not because God anointed them more than he anointed you. We all have the same measure of faith. And that's why the Apostle Paul, or the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul, is saying to us, He said, for I say through the grace of God given unto me, to every man, every woman that is among you in the body of Christ, not to think of himself or herself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, clear-minded, according as God has dealt to every man, listen, the measure of faith. So God has given to every one of us the same measure of faith. Well, Pastor, when did he give us the measure of faith? Well, I'll show you when you receive the measure of faith. Go over to the book of Ephesians, the second chapter. I'll show you where you received your measure of faith. We all came through the same route. We all came down this same street. Here the street at the address of Ephesians, the second chapter, and verse number 8. We all came to that address when before we came to Christ. When we finally accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, when we became born again, we had to come to the same address, Ephesians, the address 2:8. Praise God. Ephesians, the second chapter, verse number 8. Notice what it says right here in verse number 8. It says, for by grace, God's unmerited favor, are you saved through what? Through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Now, how is it the gift of God? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him would not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. Remember over in the book of Romans, I believe it is in the 5th chapter, it says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. While you were a sinner, Christ already died for you. Amen? Amen. Even when he was on the earth, he died for the sinners who was on the earth. He died for the apostles when they were on the earth. They were sinners, but Christ died for us first. Then after he died, then we, through the grace of God, for by grace are you saved through faith. Faith in who? Faith in Jesus and what Jesus did for us. You put your confidence in what he did for you. The Bible says, for by one man death passed upon all men, and by the obedience of one shall all be made righteous, the obedience of Jesus Christ, because he offered himself as a sacrifice for sin. Adam, through his disobedience, caused death to pass upon all men. Adam is the great, 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 great grandfather of every human being on the earth. We all come from one man and woman, which was Adam and Eve. That's why there's no such things as races. Only one race, the human race. That's why all this stuff with prejudice and stuff, racial prejudice, it's a ploy of Satan to keep man in darkness and keep them fighting among themselves when all men come from God. You get below the skin and you see all the organs look the same. In fact, they do transplant organs to one person to another person, and it doesn't matter what color their skin is. Amen? Amen? That right there proves to you. The organs, they can be tried. If they got the same blood type or whatever and stuff, it's able to transplant it. So that's of Satan. That's why Christians need their mind renewed with the Word of God. Why? Because you need to start thinking like God wants you to think. And that way you help you have compassion on all people. Amen? And not to run around with prejudice inside of you and stuff. I'll preach to them, I won't talk to them. I'll go witness to them, but I won't witness to them. I'll pray for them, but I won't pray for them. Why? Because you don't have your mind renewed with the Word of God. You don't know the truth. Jesus says, if you continue my word, then you're my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Amen? Praise God. Kids, when they grow up, they don't grow up with prejudice. You see little kids and the toddlers in there, man, they playing with one another. They don't know the difference between black, white, yellow, or pink. Amen? All to them, everybody looks the same. Amen? Amen. And then even when they get a little older than that, they still have that innocence about themselves. Yes. Yes. It's taught by society. Now, listen, he says, for by grace are you saved through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, the gift which God gave his Son to be the sacrificial lamb for the sins of the whole world, for Adam's sin. And we received that gift. We never seen Jesus die on the cross. I wasn't there. You weren't there. Nobody living today was there. Nobody 30 years ago was there. But we believe the testimony. We believe the gospel that the others have preached to us, that Jesus Christ was crucified, that he died, he went to hell, and he was raised again the third day. I believe that. You believe that. We believe it. We receive that testimony, and we receive it by faith. Faith is simply believing the word of someone and acting on it. We believe on the word of someone, and we acted upon it. Romans 10, 9 and 10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart you believe unto righteousness, with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. It's a faith operation. And that faith for you and I to become saved, my brother and sister, came from God, from his word that he had all the apostles and disciples back then in the beginning to preach, and they preached and told someone else about it, and that somebody else that got born again told somebody else about it, and that somebody that told somebody else about it told somebody else about it, and all of a sudden it passed all the way down, and then the Bibles were printed then, and somebody read the Bible, believed it, acted upon it, and it's been preached throughout the whole world, and we all heard the same gospel unto salvation, and we heard it. When we heard it, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When you heard it, then you received the same measure of faith as the other person did, and you acted upon that same measure of faith, and you became born again.
Yes, yes, yes.
We all received the same measure of faith.
Amen.
Yes. Woo, glory be to God. I think I'm preaching myself happy. I don't know about you. Yes, we all receive the same measure of faith. That's what the Bible says. We're not talking about my opinion. We definitely ain't talking about your opinion. But we're talking about what God's word says. And that's why it's important for us to teach nothing but the truth. But the truth, so help me God. And the truth is found in the word of God. Amen?
Yeah.
Romans 12, 3. You can turn back there now. We can look at that again. Now, if you are born again, if you are born again, I'm going to emphasize that, if you are born again, if you are not born again and you just going through the fundamentals and stuff and putting on and got all the cliches and you think you're born again but you haven't been born again, you can become born again. But if you are born again, then we all have faith. That's what I'm going to say. If you're born again, you still have faith. All of us received the same measure of faith when you became born again. So, this is how you can know that you have faith. Even if you just got born again, you have faith. The person that just got born again the very second ago, somewhere in the world, somebody got born again, they have the same measure of faith that you started off with. Now, notice I say, they have the same measure of faith that you started off with. But you can grow in faith. You can grow in faith, praise God. And we're going to talk about that later. That's not my subject right now. I want to prove to you that you have faith. And where faith comes, it comes, they came to you because you heard the gospel unto your salvation. Amen? The gospel and your salvation is that which you heard, and when you heard it, you believed it. When you believed it, you act upon it, and you became born again. So you know you got faith in your. I have to close there because my time is out. I want to thank you for those of you that come to the Thursday night Bible study tonight. Thank those of you that are on Periscope viewing now. Thank you that are viewing this video recording either on Facebook or the website, and those that probably received a DVD sometime in the near future. Thank you for coming here. If there may be those of you here tonight that are not born again, that is, you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to give you an opportunity to become born again. The book of Romans, the 10th chapter, verse number 9 and 10, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart you believe unto righteousness, and with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, with everybody being still right now, don't move around right now. I'm going to do this prayer. I'm going to lead you into a prayer, but I want you to be still so others can hear. It's very important because this is a very important moment. Now, Romans 10, 9 and 10 say, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart you believe unto righteousness, and with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. If you're here tonight, if you're on Periscope, if you're viewing this video, and you have not been born again, I want to lead you into prayer to get born again. By bowing your heads, I want all of y'all to repeat after me these words so that you can receive the gift of eternal life. Those of you that are already born again, please pray along with us real loud. Say, dear God,
sing that your love is sweet.
His love is divine.
advantage of you, a fair weather friend. But he will never leave or forsake you. He's with you till the end.